Mr. Melham, thank you very much for your time. There's a lot of speculation after your decision to step down as the caucus chair. What are the reasons for this move?
Well, the reasons are what I told caucus. By the end of this month, I will have served 8 years as caucus chair. The average time is 2 or 3 years as caucus chair. The previous longest was the first person did 5 years, 5 months. I felt it was time to give someone else a go. I've certainly created a lot of work in the position as chair of caucus. A couple of weeks ago, I got re-endorsed for the seat of Banks to contest my 9th election. That's a tough gig because the margin is only 2,400 votes. And I've decided to pour all my resources into winning that seat for the Labor Party. Now, this is only an honorary position, and I felt that there was enough quality in the caucus to take the position over.
We've been told that you've not
been happy for some time with the way the relationship between the cabinet and the caucus. Is that right?
Look, I occasionally get upset when people are speaking, when other people are giving reports. And I've got a nickname of Grumpy. And I make that displeasure known in the caucus. And that happened at the last caucus meeting. And we got silence, perfect silence for half an hour.
That's not against ministers, though?
Against ministers, it's against backbenchers. The whole lot. There's no distinction when you're in a caucus. They're all equal. But I've got nothing but, you know, cooperation from the Prime Minister and the previous Prime Minister, Kevin Rudd, in the time I've been chair, all the cabinet ministers, all the ministers, all the caucus. So that's a furphy. Yeah, do I get a little bit grumpy occasionally? Because I'm a perfectionist. I think people should be heard in silence. But when you've got 103 people in the room and they're all politicians, you know, it's just that aspect. But that's not a basis for resigning.
One Labor MP said, "It's a make no mistake, this is a dummy spit."
It's not a dummy spit. What it is, it's actually a vote of confidence in the way the party's actually travelling at the moment. There's a recovery. Julie Gillard's travelling very well. In the normal course of events, let's be very frank, I would have not recontested after the last election because I did 2 terms. But we were a hung parliament and I felt it was important to serve a period of this parliament. So it's not a dummy spit. If it was a dummy spit, people have known me long enough. I call a spade, I tell people the reasons I was resigning. And the reasons for me are that I want to put all my energies into my seat of Banks. And I think I've been there too long as chair of caucus.
How much work does it take to chair caucus? Well, don't you just do it when you're here?
No, look, yeah, most of it's here, but you also get rung up in your electorate. You're getting ministerial officers ringing you all the time. I'm a hands-on person, so anything that goes through the caucus, I try and massage to make sure there's a proper process, to make sure it's been before the committee. I get asked advice all the time, and I'll still give that casual advice to whoever takes my position. But there are hours involved in it. And there are technical aspects. You asked about a whole range of things. Now, look, the thing with it is, the average time is 1 term of Parliament. I'm into my 3rd term. And it's because of the confidence that I've got that someone else can take it.
So you can say hand on heart that we shouldn't read no significance into this move today from you in relation to the Prime Minister, a lack of faith or a lack of confidence in her?
None at all. Indeed, at the last ballot, I voted for the Prime Minister. The Prime Minister won 71-31. It's precisely because I've got confidence in the Prime Minister that I'm happy to make the decision now. I think it's unfair to do it later. In December, we've got a policy review committee in which the caucus chair will be heavily involved. That takes a lot of time in terms of policy. I'm not going to keep doing a job where I just don't think I can put the time in. And in this instance, it was an easy one to call.
Okay, on another issue, you nominated Peter Slipper.
Yes.
As Speaker. Oh,
yes.
Looking at the hand side.
I also nominated him when he got Deputy Speaker.
You said that without hesitation, Mr. Slipper fits the bill, fits it impeccably in terms of his service to the House. Given what we've seen the last couple of weeks, what's come through the courts, do you feel comfortable with him returning to that job?
My view is this. Politicians shouldn't be sitting in judgment in civil matters or criminal matters. These are matters for the courts. I'm a barrister at law for the state of New South Wales. I've had a practicing certificate as a barrister since 1987. This guy's going through a process at the moment. Let the cards fall where they fall. It's too peremptory at the moment. You know, there's a double jeopardy going on here. Now, I don't know what the judge is going to rule or where his court cases are going to end up. When I nominated him because of his performance within the parliament, and I'm happy to say that I still think within the parliament, running question time, is one of the best speakers I've witnessed.
But looking at some of the evidence that's public, the text messages, is his position untenable regardless of what the court decides?
I'm not prepared to make a comment on that when the matter is still before the courts. Like, This is what happened to Lindy Chamberlain. This is what happened to a whole range of other people. Whenever there's a prominent case or a prominent person tried, you've got 22 million jurors. And the Liberal Party are deliberately trying to focus on this case. Now, I don't want to see a miscarriage of justice. Now, we are admittedly in front of judges alone. We're not in front of juries. But there is a separation of powers. And at the moment, Mr. Slipper is not presiding within the parliament. He's not sitting during question time. He's not voting in legislation. He's stood to one side. Well, let his court cases be determined. Because
but can you realistically see, you've been here for many years now.
I've been here for
can
many
you realistically
years.
See a day that Peter Slipper returns to the Speaker's chair and has any semblance of respect from the crossbench in the coalition?
That's a matter for a future date. What I'm saying to you is this. I support the rule of law. And I don't support the idea that a Member of Parliament gets a second-rate justice. In other words, that he can be cannibalised by the press or the opposition continually bringing stuff in and tearing that person down. Like, we have a situation where there's another Member of Parliament where who hasn't yet to be charged, who's you know, people wanting to make judgments. That's all I'm saying. This isn't about Peter Slipper.
You don't regret nominating?
Absolutely have no regrets nominating. And, no, you know, and from my point of view, I was happy to do it on the basis of my experience with him when we served on the Legal Committee, and I chaired the Legal Committee. And I think anyone with, you know, would say that the way he conducted question time increased the dignity of the House. So he actually was doing a job that I nominated him for in terms of presiding over the Parliament. The other material has to be looked at by people who are paid to look at it, and it's not politicians because, you see, we're not independent. People are taking a position, the Shadow Attorney General, Mrs. Bishop and all that. It's not an independent position. They're running the politics on it. Well, none of us are safe.
All right, let's just finish off, if we can, where we started, your seat of Banks.
Yes.
The demographics have shifted quite significantly in that seat. Mm. The margin's a lot lower. I think yes. It's barely
1.4%, 2,400 votes.
2,400 yes. votes. Mm. David Coleman is the candidate That's for right. the Liberal Party. He looks like an impressive candidate. Are you going to win the seat?
I don't make any predictions. It's tough. I'm the underdog because it's actually not the old Banks. The last redistribution gave me half the seat of Barton all along the river. That's what's made it tough. I lost 4% of my vote as a result of the boundary changes. So I have to, you know, the next 12 months, we've just finished our council elections and everything else. So I've got clear air for the next 12 months and hopefully the government can recover and make it easier. It's not easy. I'm the underdog. That's one of the reasons, or the main reason, that I've stepped down, because every ounce of breath that I've got between now and the next election is to keep the seat in Labor's hands.
Darryl Melham, thanks for your time.
My pleasure.